Okay. So thank you very much to everyone for joining us. It's always a pleasure to have a chance to come together and discuss cultural safety, humility. And I think really these webinars are all about learning, and more importantly about learning and putting to action. So what can we learn as we listen to Leslie's presentation today? What can we take forward to move into action? And so thank you for joining us. Before we get going, we always like to give people a bit of an orientation to WebEx. For those of you who haven't used it before, you know, we do rely on the chat box, and we've invited people to introduce themselves in the chat box. You can see there's a bunch of action in there, so welcome everyone. So if you haven't already done so, on the bottom right-hand corner, you can actually take a few moments and just ensure you're picking to send to all participants and have a little reading. Let us know who you are and where you're from. But here's some of the tips around using WebEx. We're not going to be digging into a lot of the pointers, et cetera, today, but just so you know how this infrastructure works as we're joining forces today to look at cultural safety and humility. In terms of WebEx audio, one thing that we find is really good, and if you didn't do it today, that's okay, a little bit of teaching for next time. When you join the WebEx, if you actually get it to call you or phone in after you've already dialed in using the access code, it'll actually link your name to the phone number, and that makes it really easy for us to mute and unmute your lines when we have questions. So just a little tip for moving forward. And here's a little instructions on what to do if for some reason the audio didn't work for you. I know some people sometimes have challenges. WebEx can be a bit tricky if you haven't had a chance to use it before. But if there's no phone icon beside your name, what you can always do is stay on WebEx and hang up the telephone, and a pop-up window will appear. And if not, you can just click on the audio button, and then that'll give you the dial-in details. We do recommend that you try and dial in using your phone versus a headset on your computer. The sound quality is a bit better for those of you who are joining us. It's always nice to be able to hear. And as I mentioned before, we do invite you all to introduce yourselves in the chat panel. Lots of action and lots of people joining us. We have 87 people on the call already right now. We invite you to introduce yourself to the chat panel and let us know your name and where you're from. So that's again on the bottom right-hand side. And just make sure you send it to all participants so we can all see what you have to say. We'll also leverage that later today. If you have any questions at the end of Leslie's presentation or throughout the presentation, we'll be keeping our eyes open for any questions that are popping up there. Almost last but not least, we are recording. We just wanted to remind everyone that this session is being recorded. We record these sessions so people who can't make it can actually still access them. And if you, you know, have a burning desire to watch this again, it will be posted on the FNHA website. And Sue on the mark, incredibly so, has just posted the link into the chat box there. So you can click on that and bookmark it, share it with your friends, colleagues, etc. So all of our past sessions have been recorded there as well. I already covered this one so that they are posted on the website. For those of you who are on Twitter, we invite you to tweet away. So Leslie is on Twitter herself. Actually, we follow each other, and it's always a pleasure to see them on Twitter. So there's Leslie's Twitter handle. We also invite you to use the host of today's session, our FNHA and the council here. So please go ahead and use any of these Twitter handles and our cultural humility, or it starts with a hashtag. So those are here, and you'll notice on the main body of the slides, they're along the bottom piece here, and Sue has kindly popped those into the chat box. Now, often some of the material we cover in these sessions can be sensitive. And due to the sensitive nature, we just want to ensure that people have a support system in place. Please ensure you've got a place you can go, whether it's an elder, a trusted friend, somebody you can link out to. And if for some reason you find you don't have that network around you, we are providing the toll-free crisis line here, the 1-800-588-8717. So just to make sure you've got that number at hand. We want to make sure people have the support they need, because often we touch on topics that are difficult. So 1-800-588-8717. So we really want to acknowledge, unfortunately, our wonderful elder who usually joins us could not join us today. Virginia is not here. But we do really want to acknowledge the host territory. And particularly the council, our main office is in Vancouver downtown, and we want to acknowledge the unceded territory of the Coast Salish. Specifically, Musqueam, and Squamish Nations that we are visitors on today. And we also want to acknowledge the territories that each of you are on. We know we're spread out across the province and across the country, so just really acknowledging our hosts whose land we're on today for each of our sessions. It's with pleasure now I get to hand it over to Leslie. So I'm just thrilled that it worked out for Leslie to be able to join us today. So Leslie is a member of the Tzeachten First Nation, and she's an Aboriginal Health Executive with Vancouver Coastal Health. And in her role there, she provides strategic guidance to the CEO and the senior executive team at Vancouver Coastal Health on sort of challenges, priorities and issues relating to improving the health of the Indigenous population. Previously to her role with Vancouver Coastal Health, Leslie was the Aboriginal Health Director at Fraser Health for 8 years. So she comes to us with some seasoning in terms of her experience in the system. In this role, she's provided leadership with Fraser Health around planning, supporting, and guiding the implementation of initiatives designed to improve the health of Indigenous people. And then prior to working in healthcare, Leslie provided business support and consulting services to First Nations communities and organizations in the Fraser Valley, including project management, communication strategies, and policy development. So we've got some real knowledge and wisdom here. So Leslie's extensive experience around Indigenous health, sort of around strategic leadership, policy, primary healthcare, and community-based healthcare delivery. So it's truly our pleasure to be able to hand it over to Leslie now to give thanks and have her share her wisdom with us. So I'm going to hand you the ball, Leslie, and you can navigate from here.
Thank you very much, Colleen and team behind the scenes there. And thank you for acknowledging the Coast Salish territories. Our office is located here, as well as Musqueam, Squamish, Tsleil-Waututh. We're over here on 2750 East Hastings down by the P&E, and I know lots of people like to come and visit us here during the P&E. So welcome everyone who has joined. Thank you for joining us. In the absence of prayer and in alignment with recognizing that I'm an Indigenous woman from the Coast Salish Territory, I wanted to introduce myself a little further through this slide, which represents my larger Tzeachten community in the top picture. This is circa 1967, so I was literally 2 years old. And this is the Tzeachten First Nation at the corner of Vetter Road and Promontory. And it does not look like that anymore, as you can imagine. The development there is my First Nations community has a Save-On Foods and a bunch of shops on that particular corner, along with our Tzeachten First Nations Community Hall. The next picture, the bottom one, is my more tightly close family. My grandmother, who has been one of the greatest inspirations to my life, and her two sisters, and their children. And so I'm the one sitting on my grandmother's knee, the lady with the glasses, and again, I am always recognizing and introducing myself as my grandmother's granddaughter. And the fellow in the back, the older gentleman, is my grandfather. His name is Siamatol. Siamatol is one of our oldest recorded names in Stolo territory. The next picture is very current. It is my family, my grown children, and my grandchildren, and my husband and I celebrating one of my nephew's weddings in Tofino this August long weekend. I wanted to add this picture because this is truly the inspiration to why I chose to do this work. It's not only because I'm very passionate about the Indigenous population and improving healthcare, but it really has been instilled upon me and my husband that you always look to the next generations and make sure that you're paving the way for them. So that is in the spirit of which I do this work, and what I bring to my work is that as a mother, a grandmother, a daughter, a sister, an auntie, and a granddaughter. And really want to instill that that is by far the greatest contribution I could possibly make to this work besides just the regular business and years of experience. So that's my grounding part to my intention for today, is to bring that piece of myself to the work and to share with you how I've learned and how I've managed to navigate that in these systems as an Indigenous woman. So again, the next slide is really about what is the intention today? Well, of course, Colleen, I can never say no to Colleen, and First Nations Health Authority, again, very committed and passionate about the cultural safety of our population within our health authority systems. Having worked in two health authorities and been around for, well, 12 years doing this now, helping to shape and change how our regional health authorities deliver care, culturally safe care for our population. So today I want to share some components of the how we've managed to do that. I want to recognize the need to define some of those commitments into actions, how you actually move things from, you know, writing and saying them and declaring them to actually making them happen in our health authorities. I joined Vancouver Coastal Health after many years working with Fraser Health in October 2015. And one of the main reasons, the drivers, one of the decision-making factors on me actually joining Vancouver Coastal Health was because they had this beautiful policy already in place. In July 2015, the senior executive team and our led by our CEO endorsed a policy, and the policy was one of a kind. I wasn't aware of such a policy in a health authority yet, and I think everybody is kind of catching up to that movement now. But the policy identified really three key areas for Vancouver Coastal Health that was really a statement of commitment, that we would improve health outcomes, but would also improve Aboriginal leadership in healthcare. We would always acknowledge First Nations traditional territories everywhere we went. And one other big one was incorporating and allowing for space, culturally safe ceremonial spaces in all of our acute sites. Part of that, along with our CEO, all other CEOs of the regional health authorities also committed. So here we were really seeing, after all of these years from back in 2005 to 2007, when the work was happening around BC First Nations and the province of BC, talking about improving health outcomes, sharing some of the decision making, setting goals and priorities together, we also had this need to have one of the biggest health bodies, which is the regional health authorities, come on board with that. And they always did in a very a partnership way with their local First Nations. I recall when I worked at Fraser Health, being Stolo, which is really the Fraser Health territory, we had a wonderful, beautiful ceremony with Dr. Nigel Murray in about 2008. Where we actually, as a Stolo person, working with my elders and with their cultural guidance, Ginny Peters, as a matter of fact, who is your elder as part of this work, we actually performed an honoring ceremony with our CEO of Fraser Health, Dr. Murray. And through that process, we put the blanket across both shoulders. That's a sign of honoring. And through this process, this became our memorandum of understanding. So again, even back in 2008, I really tried to ensure that we were decolonizing our processes. So not signing another commitment, although I see place and need for signing commitments. This was a way of using our cultural practices in Stolo territory to have Dr. Nigel Murray, on behalf of Fraser Health, declare his commitment verbally, as an oral tradition in our area, verbally to the community members and the health leaders in Fraser Region. It was a beautiful ceremony. And again, instead of saying we have an MOU, we would say we had this ceremony and use the witnesses and call upon the witnesses from that ceremony that day to help hold that Fraser Health Authority to the commitment that Dr. Nigel Murray made back in 2008. But sometimes we still need these kinds of things, the Provincial Declaration of Commitment. And I think even through those processes, I've witnessed First Nations Health Authority also resurrect and use some of those honoring ceremonies and blanketing ceremonies in order to help hold people and bring them into this commitment. The other thing that certainly everybody has heard about now is this Truth and Reconciliation Calls to Action. And it really is a call to action. Sometimes people call them goals. They're not goals. They're actually calls to action. I think that language and remembering that that is language that was chosen very intentionally, because anybody can own a goal. It's about really making sure that people are aware of what their action needs to be. So call to action, call for an increase in the number of Aboriginal professionals working in healthcare fields, ensuring the retention of Aboriginal healthcare providers in Aboriginal communities. Retention is one of those goals that we really need to keep our eye on. Retention will indicate whether or not people like myself continue to feel safe in the environment in which we work. I always say it's most key to me to identify if somebody has stayed and they stay in that job and they stay with that health authority, they stay with that health clinic or First Nations community, it means they have felt welcome and they have felt safe to be in their Indigenous self in that workplace. And also a really big call to action is provide culturally competency training for all healthcare professionals. That is one lofty goal, let me tell you, as being somebody who leads some of the activity around providing cultural safety training in a system with 20,000 plus employees, no small task, but at least it's being shared by all of us. There are also most recently, in March of 2017, as part of the lovely forum that Colleen and her team put on, the BC Health regulatory bodies also all signed on this commitment. And if anything is going to spark a lot of attention into the cultural safety training that we do provide, it is this group. We have had such an increase in folks wanting to take on our training because their regulatory body has actually communicated and socialized that commitment. So, how do we put cultural safety and humility into practice? Again, taking that commitment into action has to be a system-wide approach. After years of working in health authorities, I certainly recognize that policy statements, commitments from senior executive, commitments from the ministry are all fantastic. But when it actually lands within our health authorities, it would be easy for it to just stick and stay with Aboriginal health, which would be impossible for us to move forward as we're a small but mighty team of about 20. So we really wanted to take a look at if this is going to happen, the most effective way for it to happen is to make sure that we are shooting off in all directions and touching in every area. And so our strategy has really been built around how do we inform a whole system as strategic leaders, perhaps, or a term I like to use is that we are internal consultants to the system. So our team of subject matter experts, most of our team, I would say 95% of our team members are Indigenous themselves. We come from all sorts of backgrounds, lived experience, as well as wonderful training. And what we've done is created a team based on all of those commitments and work that we said we were going to do. So instead of populating an org chart with a bunch of positions that we think we need, what I was able to do, being new here 2 years ago, was actually engineer and build out a team that started way over on the right-hand side of the org chart, outlining all of the commitments and the directives that we have signed on for, and worked this way to populate it with the type of positions we would need to fill that work. So not everybody gets that position. Not everybody is able to design their team based on the work that needs to get done. Usually it's the other way. It's function follows form as opposed to form following function. So super key for this type of work, you have to be very intentional and ensure that you've got the right kind of expertise in order to change that and affect the change. So what we looked at was every level within the organization, from governance to that front line, to the policy builders, to the communities, and worked in a way that said, how are we going to align with what the cultural safety framework and roadmap for system transformation that came from the ministry and was a very provincial-led system and directive, to the provincial goals of There's three very firm provincial goals, and kind of plotting ourselves forward by using those frameworks, but really indigenizing them at the same time. I have to say it's an interesting task, and you have to ensure that the people that are informing this process are really clear on their intention. And I'll use the word intention a lot because that's what our elders tell us to do. We are always setting out our intention first, and then we start the work. So make sure that when you're starting this type of work, you've got all the well-intended people who are going to stay authentic and engaged to the indigenizing of this work. It's not a word, but we're using it as a word, indigenizing the work, hardwiring that Indigenous lens to the change and the transformation is really key. I'm fortunate enough to be surrounded by very wise people. We have a circle of elders here at our office who come and enjoy a lunch and a circle once a month. And whenever I have a question where I need a little support from them, I can go to that table and they are happy to provide direction and input into what we are doing here. That way, again, being authentic and engaged and true to the intention of making sure that the Indigenous voice and those elders who have been holding this knowledge know what we were, how well we were in the past, are the ones that we really want to inform our process going forward. Some of the ways that we've hardwired the Indigenous lens into everything we do, again, as a leader within this system, recognizing that I want to ensure that I'm always looking at things from a decolonizing lens. How would we have done it in the past? How were we in the past? How well were we in the past? So what we've done is one of the key pieces of work that we finally managed to complete is this lovely little booklet. It is called the Aboriginal Cultural Practices, a Guide for Physicians and Allied Healthcare Professionals Working at Vancouver Coastal Health. And this literally took a year for us to build. There was a ton of engagement with our elders and our First Nations community members and tested through some of our clinical teams within our different acute sites. And what it actually has is a whole bunch of tab sections, a real quick, easy reference for our hospital staff to take a look at if they come across. Let's just pull one up here. There's a section on traditional foods, cultural valuables, spiritual practices and blessings, end-of-life protocols, and it really is a beautiful reference that through a very intentional and safe practice of gathering information and making it available that is not too specific to cultural practices and that we're making that available to everyone in the healthcare system, but it gives people something. When they feel like they don't have anyone to reach out to in the moment, but they've got an Indigenous patient in their emergency department or something, they actually have something they can quickly refer to that might help them advance the conversation with that patient. The other one, that poster there, we've got this great poster campaign that we were just building off of Cultural Safety Starts With Me, or It Starts With Me campaign that First Nations Health Authority launched. We too have another one called Cultural Safety Starts With Me. And we have leaders throughout Vancouver Coastal Health that have made their commitment known to cultural safety, and we have taken great photos and created all these posters and have them about to launch them into all of the hospitals throughout our organization. Again, I think it's the key point there is when you are making a commitment and leaders are demonstrating that commitment, the others will follow. So this particular one is Andy Day, head of primary health care in the Vancouver Community of Care, essentially a downtown east side partner, and he has just been absolutely phenomenal in ensuring that every time he's sitting at a table, he's thinking about, oh, I wonder what Leslie would think of this, or, you know, again, it's built on this relational thing that happens as director to director in these health systems is when we get those relationships and create allies in our system, they will help to do the work. And it is their work, and we're there to help them do it. Some of the other achievements, some of the drawings on there, the pictures on there, are things that we actually shamelessly stole and copied from our leader over in Northern Health Authority, who were the first ones to come up with the new kind of complaints, compliments, concerns brochure, and we really followed their format and created our own. We've also created a sacred spaces and gathering places for each of our acute sites. So wherever our Indigenous population travels in any of our facilities in Vancouver Coastal, we hope that they will be able to access one of these brochures and they will know in advance where them and their families can gather at one of our hospitals. The other way that we have been trying to, again, spread the responsibility of Indigenous health throughout the health authority is by things like this, webinars, workshops. We've done Indigenous cultural safety training within our system. We've trained over 500 people already. That, along with the folks that we register in the SANYAS PHSA program, which is usually around 150 a year. So on top of being able to provide SANYAS online training, we do an in-person. And in fact, our team is being deployed out to Seychelles later this week to, again, provide training for a team out in the Seychelles Hospital. We've created a library. The lending library is meant to, we're just populated with some of these great books. Everybody's probably familiar with some of these. We've got some great titles that we will make available for the groups that have gone through our online, or either the online training or our in-person training. We want to keep the momentum going. I know that when we train people, we start to open their minds, and then they're like, give me more, give me more. And we thought, well, how can we actually keep them interested and engaged? And so creating other opportunities. We have video blogs, which I guess is a new language, vlogs, that we've done. We've done some podcasts with our elder Jerry Ullman, which we'll be making available very soon. We've got this lovely book of library, this lovely library of books. Webinars, all of these workshops, guest speakers, lunch and learns. You'll see that little lovely picture of a beautiful lunch there and a lunch bag. So we've got all of this little swag too to go along with us to entice people to keep coming back to our lunch and learns when we hold them. Again, just building off of momentum and interest, the hashtags and the social media that we use. We've got a great Facebook page that we keep very active on a daily basis of what's happening. And so far, through that, we have gained a lot of traction. So people are now seeking other opportunities that are happening throughout the city of Vancouver. You know, this is the city of reconciliation, the 150-plus celebrations that were happening in the city. Our folks are going to that because they've piqued interest in learning more about the Indigenous population. Media helps with the truth and reconciliation. The city of Vancouver certainly helped. We've built stronger and better relationships with our local First Nations. Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh provide the cultural training along with us. Intention is always to bring forward the Indigenous knowledge first, supported by our knowledge in our health authority of how things work and what needs to happen. So you see this picture of Chief Ian Campbell from Squamish Nation has been an incredible partner with us. He's spoken at many of our different events. He's hosted us in his longhouse in Squamish Nation. And it really is a reciprocal relationship that has been happening between him and us. And he's learning from us and we're learning from him. It's very good. And he has shared songs and the history of the land, which, you know, Vancouver Coastal Health has many facilities throughout the territory, and really understanding what used to be here prior to our bricks and mortar building has been real eye-opening and really interesting to learn. So again, reminding people that this is the traditional lands of Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh means we need to know their stories. We need to know what they used to do here on this site. There's an old building being renovated in the downtown east side where the Squamish Nation was able to provide a whole history and story of how that particular land was used for harvesting and the seasonal work that used to happen there. And I think that is just brilliant. That always brings us back to the understanding that the Squamish people were here long before everyone else. So a key learning point at every turn. We also have had incredible partnership and relationships with not only our First Nations Health Authority partner, of course, and our First Nations, but also the City of Vancouver. And we have a very strong urban Aboriginal partnership agency here called the Metro Vancouver Aboriginal Exec Council, MVAC for short. And they represent somewhere around 22 different agencies. And so they have been an incredible partner in helping us to provide training and opportunities for Vancouver Coastal staff as well as all of the city partners and different agencies in town. Corporate Canada is thirsty for this knowledge, and we're trying to meet and support some of that work. Now, everything sounds pretty rosy right now, I'm sure, but these initiatives transformation and new opportunities don't come without some challenges and opportunities, of course. And one of the biggest things that I try to remind people of is systems don't change, right? There's a fictitious, oh, we're going to change the system. The system is simply people. There's the doers in the system, and that people are what change the system. I've had these conversations with some of our Indigenous community members where, oh, blame it on the system. And I agree, there's a lot of system problems, but in all sorts of areas, not just health. But systems are simply the mechanisms and process of a bunch of people making decisions and imposing policies and processes in those systems. So not to lose track that the most important thing to do is focus on the people. And I have to say, as part of leadership in the system, I am happy to say that the changes that I've seen over the last 10 plus years have really been because of the people I have worked with in these systems. There's been some fantastic leaders, and there are fantastic leaders who, when I meet them and start asking them to come on board and help us with applying an Indigenous lens to their work, are, oh, thank you. You know, they needed some help getting started. They needed to know that it was okay for them to take that step. I don't know how many people I've met that said, oh, I didn't think I could call, or I didn't think I could go to the First Nations community. I didn't know I could go to the reserve, and things like that, which is, it's really unfortunate. So a lot of times we're spending a lot of our conversations around myth-busting and the fact that our First Nations communities don't have everything they possibly could need, and everything isn't all funded and free for them. So, you know, we're really concentrating on having conversations with our leaders throughout the health authority to help affect the change. And I say there is an opportunity at every turn. I see opportunity every time I have a conversation with somebody, every time I go to a meeting, every time I pick up a paper or a research paper or watch a webinar or get invited to a meeting. I see change absolutely everywhere. It's the most, recognizing that it's an opportunity and also encouraging your team. So our Aboriginal Health team, we know we are the change. I remind our team all the time, we are the change. Don't expect to walk in to the change. because we are part of the change. So what role do you play in part of this change? You play the role of as an educator. Every opportunity, there's a teachable moment in there where we can ask for something different, where we can share a different perspective. That's my next point, really, is change is the opportunity, and I firmly believe that. This commitment, all of these commitments that have been made, lead us to the change we're looking for, and change is opportunity to have different conversations. And then, of course, making it safe. I have to set the intentions and set the tone for almost every meeting I go into to advise people, you will not hurt me by asking me a question. A lot of people hold back asking their questions because they're afraid they'll hurt my feelings, that what they say will be culturally inappropriate as an Indigenous person. So we as Indigenous people, leaders in these places of work, also need to let people know it's going to be okay to be vulnerable and ask that question. It's okay. I won't take it personally. And asking it is better than going away with your assumptions. So making it safe to do so is really important. Some of the key things, I think, I just jotted down a few that really resonate with me all the time to keep in mind, is make it public. Spread the news. Like I said, back in 2008 when Dr. Murray made the declaration to our population that he was going to ensure that him and his leadership team were going to improve the health status of Aboriginal people, we made that very public. We created media blasts about it. If you see all of these signing ceremonies that have been going on, we've made public. First Nations Health Authority has done a fantastic job through their communications department to make things public. And we're trying to do that too. We use our internal VCH News to tell every little story possible in VCH News so that it just spreads. So there's this constant presence in these news stories that all of a sudden we have a higher profile within our health authority. All of a sudden people go, oh, there's Aboriginal, look what they're doing over there. And they get inquisitive and they want to know more. So spread the news, make it public. It shouldn't be a secret to the general public that our health authorities and all of these systems have made this commitment to culturally safe care. That way, even our population as they enter into our system should recognize the difference in the care. They should recognize that they've been greeted differently or asked if they would like to see somebody from cultural practice or from our Aboriginal patient navigators. Another thing is celebrate the small accomplishments. Every little inch we move forward in ensuring that our 20,000 some odd staff and 100,000 across the province are experiencing change, making sure that we share and celebrate some of those small accomplishments. And reward the allies. We always make sure we recognize our allies. Everyone we recruit, we're like, oh, you're, you know, certificates, thank you. Making it public, giving them kudos in public is super important because that everybody loves that, let's be real. Everybody loves to be recognized for what they've done and what they can contribute. The other thing is keep it real simple. So our team, we try to make sure that when we are offering something, all you literally have to do is sign up for it and get yourself to the training. We do everything else. And also when we're encouraging teams, we'll go to teams, we will make presentations, we'll custom adapt any of our training to suit the team. So again, keeping it simple, making it easily available, not cumbersome, not super time sensitive as well. Like you can't contribute, or you can't always commit to 8 hours, 10 hours, 3 days, 5 days, but you can always, you can usually commit to a 5 minute, 10 minute talk. So that's why we've decided we'll make as many little snippets as possible. Bring in and use local knowledge and respect local knowledge. That is really key. The Indigenous population wants to be a part of this. They want to contribute. Like I said, we're so fortunate in the elders that have come along with us and have contributed to our work, the First Nations community cultural leaders who have come on board and shared their wisdom, opened their longhouses to us, and helped us to provide culturally safe care. Through storytelling, I think, is the number one thing. It really resonates with people. And I think, too, when we connect at that human level first, like I said, I always introduce myself as a mother and a grandmother, and because that is who I am. That is what I bring to my work. As an Indigenous woman, I feel like I bring even more responsibility. And making that real and sharing that helps everybody else kind of sit back and go into their mother, father role and see themselves from that human part about how would they want their family served in our health system. So I will pause with that. We're certainly not in this alone. I'm so happy that I can say that Aboriginal Health in Vancouver Coastal Health is not alone. We're part of the system that is changing and transforming, but I do not feel like we have the sole responsibility. I know the system is responding well, but it does start with me, and it does start with every conversation I have with anybody, and I'm happy to say that the work has been very rewarding. It's a challenge, but it is rewarding, and I'm happy to be part of the movement of cultural safety in healthcare. Thank you so much. I hope I sparked a little bit of interest and dialogue amongst the participants, and I guess I'll pass it over to you, Colleen, and open up the chat box and see if we have any questions.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Leslie. Twitter has been very active with lots of amazing tweets, kind of echoing some of the really solid messages you sent today for your session. As we kind of move forward today, there's already been some questions filled in the chat box, so we invite people to put more questions in the chat box. I'll try and capture some of the ones. The first thing we've seen appearing a few times is some of those amazing resources you shared with us, such as the Aboriginal Cultural Practices resource. Are those available online to folks outside of Vancouver Coastal Health? And if so, could you direct us there? Or is it something we could share after today's session? And also, for those within Vancouver Coastal Health, how do they access?
Yeah, we've just, they're literally hot off the press. It took us so long to finalize every last word because, you know, words are important and we wanted to make sure we had exactly what we wanted. The resource is beautiful and we do hope that each of the other regional health authorities can use it as a guide in developing their own. This one's very Vancouver Coastal specific. And what we've done is we've printed off enough copies to supply our hospitals. I just spoke with our communications specialist, just yesterday actually, asking for him to find out and source a way for others to actually order their own copies. So I'd be happy to share a couple, and of course the electronic version can be made available on our website and also by email. So maybe I'll offer to send that to you, Colleen, and those that have been in attendance today that want a copy, we'll make it available.
Fantastic. With your permission, we could distribute it to everyone who attended today as a follow-up to today's call. That would be brilliant. And so thank you so much for that kind offer. The questions are just flooding in, so I hope I keep up with all of them. Another question that came in is, where does the online PHSA SANYAS training fit into relationship to the other resources and strategies you've discussed today? So where does SANYAS training fit into all of this?
SANYAS is still one of the tools we've got in our toolkit. So for years, we've been offering SANYAS training online with PHSA. And it has been very well received. People absolutely love the program. But the big but was some people would say, yeah, but what next? What else, right? So again, that opening of minds and getting people interested and encouraged to learn more has been our biggest challenge. Okay, we've opened these minds, now we need to give more information. So that's why we've come up with a whole bunch of other strategies and other tools to use for those people that, one, can't commit to the Sanyas online training, or simply aren't those kind of learners. Not everybody can sit and learn through an online process, and I recognize that. I'm probably one of them. You know, so I like little snippets of information. I read magazines as opposed to books because I can read short editorials as opposed to reading the whole story. You know, so everybody learns differently, and we recognize that. So we want to make sure that we give as many learning opportunities as possible. So we keep building our toolkit. And we have gotten ourselves a presence on our internal CCRS platform. Don't even ask me what CCRS stands for, but anyway, it is our course register system, I guess. So we are creating inside of VCH a portal so that the VCH staff can go to that and you can see this whole suite of opportunities and material. Oh, there's one piece I forgot to show. This is our little... Our whole team, you know, we have the Be Well, and Be Well is on so many different pieces of medicine bags with the Be Well logo. The bears are meant for our new little Indigenous people that are born in our hospitals. And again, just, yeah, we've created a bit of swag, but it was purposeful, and it was funded by a beautiful grant we got from one of our foundations. So it was a foundation grant that launched all of this material, the purchase of the books, the webinar material, and the creation of the Aboriginal Cultural Practices Guidelines. Happy to share about that process too, and how to accomplish writing one of these practice books.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that. And Jillian just commented on that from the College of Pharmacists that she's really impressed with the variety of resources that are coming out here. It's just amazing. And you've done so much work there. So kudos to you and your team, Leslie. Another question that's come up on the chat box is, what are some elements of your in-person training session? Could you go a little bit more deeply into that?
Well, boy, I wish I would have had the slide ready that the word cloud from all the feedback and evaluations. I can honestly say after all these years of doing training internally and the health authorities, I have not seen such positive response in evaluations ever before. So the difference in our in-house, in-person training is we have a master's trained clinical counselor leading, and she actually is able to really help people connect this to this. So it is not just learning from here. It's learning and going really into yourself and who you are. And it's a process. And they, between the two trainers, they do it so beautifully that people can't help but be very, very human in these trainings. So it gets very, very personal while they are learning. And it's a three-hour training. It's, we prefer it to be delivered here in our location where we have indigenized our whole office. So you come in and you sense that you're in a very safe and sacred space. And yeah, it's just been so warmly received. I read comments from every single class, and we do it in a cohort, so it's teams coming in together. Teams that work with each other, the whole idea is build allies, hold each other accountable, hold each other up, help each other through these things. So it's really important that they are these cohorts of teams. And the comments of, this has changed my life, I didn't know this, I'm going to tell my family and my friends, and, you know, because it goes into the history of Indigenous people, but it takes them right up to current day and these commitments that we've made and the role that they play in helping us to change the system.
amazing. I popped that in the chat box because I think what you said is so important there. You know, build allies, hold each other accountable, and hold each other up. You know, that whole concept of building up and what we can do in terms of that, the snowball effect of building up and what that has in terms of potential for the system. Oh, the questions are coming in, so I don't want to miss any of these. Another one that came in, Leslie, was how does Vancouver Coastal Health know what kind of experiences of care Indigenous people are having? So how do they know what kind of experiences of care Indigenous people are having, and how can we know it's changing?
Yes. Well, we have a proof of concept that we started with one of our hospitals, and we haven't launched it yet because all of the material was being developed, and we're waiting for confirmation, so I can't even state right now which hospital it is, but believe me, it's one of our biggest hospitals. And the idea of the proof of concept is we go in and we literally saturate the site with all sorts of Indigenous cultural safety training opportunities, lunch and learns, webinars, the elders and residents. The whole concept is all built out that way. But what we did prior to that was we actually went out and had conversations in community through a community engagement process, saying, please share with us what your experiences have been like in our hospitals. And not to open it up to hear every awful story or every good story, you know, but just to get a sense so we have a baseline. So from there we can actually start to see a year from now if that needle has moved and people are experiencing something different. So not easy to do. You do have to be authentic, intentional, and engaged in order to truly hear from the population so that you can get some sort of baseline. We don't like to be surveyed as Indigenous people, so come and have a conversation with us, learn from us, and we've had many opportunities to do that. We hold something called Natsamat, Indigenous Women's Wellness Day. We have it coming up September 14th. We held it last October, where we heard from over 300 Indigenous women from the downtown east side, through engagement, through conversation, through over coffee, learning from each other. And we're doing that again this September. We will hear again whether or not things have changed since last year, because we've done a lot of training down in the downtown east side. So I hope we see and hear a new story. And it will be from the perspective of a narrative inquiry and a narrative report. So we have been trained on how to take that narrative and turn it into a report.
That sounds like something we're going to want to hear more about moving forward, Leslie. So stay tuned, everyone. I think that's an amazing topic.
Yeah.
Thank you for that. I'm just going to do this last question. I know you have to sneak away. Leslie, we want to thank you so much for joining us. The last question is, what do you see as being the biggest gaps in knowledge and resources in this topic, and where do you see your team going in the upcoming year? So where's the biggest opportunity, I guess, relating to that gap in knowledge and resources?
What I would like to see as being addressed first and foremost is mobilization of Indigenous knowledge from the Indigenous knowledge keepers. So, you know, speaking with our elders, speaking with some of our cultural leaders in community, and it goes back to my days at Fraser with my Stolo elders and cultural teachers. For so long, and former Chief Willie Charlie used to say this, for so long we were taught not to talk about it, that we weren't allowed to share our cultural practices. But things have changed and things have evolved, that we as Indigenous people are now more comfortable in sharing parts of our cultural practice if it means a change in how you see us and how you treat us. So I think that is, we're at this crossroads now where we have to keep encouraging and keep supporting our Indigenous knowledge keepers so that they can mobilize that knowledge to benefit their people. For us as a health authority, a big leap and a big change is recognizing that Indigenous knowledge as we would somebody with a PhD. And there's been talk about that, right? Like, these knowledge keepers have lifelong learning that we need to know about, and without that we can't have this act of reconciliation. We don't know what we're reconciling until we hear about the past. If we understand about the history of our Indigenous population, we can't move forward without it, and we need the story told by them.
It's an incredible point there, Leslie, and I think an amazing way to sum up today's session. Can't thank you enough for taking the time. I know you have a busy life and schedule, and just to take the time to join us, to share your experience, the work you've been doing with Vancouver Coastal Health, to share some of these amazing resources that you're helping to advance this work and continuing to have us move forward toward the system that is culturally safe, and as we all practice cultural humility in the work that we do. So I cannot thank you enough on behalf of all the participants
today,
the council and FNHA, that you could join us. So thank you. I know Leslie has to go, so thank you so much, Leslie. We so appreciate your time today and sharing.
Thank you.
Take care. As we wrap up today, everyone, just thank you all for taking the time to join us. We've had some questions and discussion, and I know Leslie needs to head off to another session. Just before we wrap up today, we wanted to let you know we do have our final Cultural Safety Humility webinar coming up on October 4th from 12 until 1 o'clock. My apologies that we don't have our final speaker arranged. I'm very sad to let you know that our speaker, unfortunately, for medical reasons, is no longer able to join us. So we're just currently in discussions and negotiations for our speaker for the October session, but stay tuned because who we've got in the wings is going to be amazing. So stay tuned for more information through our normal regular communication channels, the council event page, and through FNHA and council newsletters. We'll be sharing this information. Sue's kindly popped up in the chat box the location of the session slides and recording where we'll be posting this, and we will work with Leslie to get a copy of the resource that she shared with us today and make sure we can get that back to you all as well. Last but not least, we do ask you to take a couple minutes to do a survey. We do find that we learn so much from these, so it will pop up automatically at the end of today's webinar. If you could please take a couple minutes, a very few minutes of your time, just to complete it. We read every one of these surveys. We really use them to help inform next steps and some of the topics that you want to see here. So thank you very much to everyone. Have an amazing day. Please take a couple minutes to see this, to complete the survey, and we hope to see you all in October. Thank you.